Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us. My name is Sonny Kelsey, and I'm a Georgetown alum and someone who bothers Matt Seifer on a regular basis. Today's webinar broadcast is presented by the Steer Center for Global Real Estate, and it is being recorded. If you miss any portion of the conversation, the recording will be made available on Georgetown's Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours. And you'll also receive a link to the recorded webinar and an email, which will go out later on. Today's session is being moderated. It's a moderated discussion, featuring the director of Steer Center for Global Real Estate, Matthew Seifer, and the director of the Center of Global Health Science and Security, Dr. Rebecca Katz. Following their conversation, we'll take audience questions via the questions feature. And look, finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, which I did have, or other issues, you can submit those concerns to our webinar administrator in the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. I'm going to do a quick intro of Matt. I don't think Matt needs much of an introduction. He's obviously the director of the Steer Center for Global Real Estate and a total rock star. He spent his career before that. I think part of the reason he was such a rock star is in addition to having an academic background, he's got a practical business background, having been the director of underwriting at Invesco for a number of years before coming to us. I don't hold it against him, but he went to Texas A&M for his PhD and master's, and actually never knew that you went to Penn State, and that explains a lot.
Right.
With that, over to you, Matt.
Sonny, thank you very much, man. I appreciate you as always. We appreciate you always being willing to help us with these kinds of events. You're obviously my PR guy too, so I appreciate you, my friend. We are here to have what I hope to be a very interesting and engaging conversation. You know, part of what we're trying to accomplish at Georgetown is to meet with our alumni and our parents and our friends in a virtual world and to remain relevant in the conversations that we're having today. And it's also an opportunity to leverage parts of the university that we might not have historically done just through the circumstances that we have today. And the example that we're gonna have in this conversation concerning infectious disease and trying to get everybody back into the built environment is a perfect example of that. And we're very pleased and privileged to have Professor Rebecca Katz with us. Professor Katz is a professor and she is the director of the Center for Global Health Science and Security at Georgetown University. She teaches, of course, in addition to research, but her teaching is on global health diplomacy, global health security, and emerging infectious diseases, all of which she teaches within the School of Foreign Service, which is one of our very proud colleges within Georgetown. Prior to that, she was at GW, and we won't hold that against her. She's on the faculty there at the Milken Institute. Since 2007, a lot of her work, among other things, has been on global governance of public health emergencies. So what better person to have available to us here today? And I will say, too, from 2004 to 2019, she consulted with the State Department on issues of pandemic influenza and disease surveillance. And so we're very thrilled to have you here, Rebecca. We certainly recognize that you're not a real estate expert, which is exactly why you're here. So we're anxious to hear you educate us. And you know, as we talked about in sort of the prep call, the people that are largely on the phone are investors, owners in real estates, and you know, individuals involved in the services, you know, industry within real estate, you know, tenants. I think a number of my Invesco colleagues are on, so it's good to see them signed up. But, you know, we'll start with maybe your view, if you will, of the reopening process. Clearly, we're getting started. You know, DC is obviously phase one, and other parts of the country are ahead of us and some are behind maybe, but can you talk a little bit about your view of the, you know, the reopening process nationally? And I know your center has done a really nice job of putting together materials for these sort of decision makers that are charged with opening up the economies that I found to be very helpful, and I appreciate those. So, you know, how are we doing?
Well, first, really, really appreciate the opportunity to speak with with all of you today. To your point, you know, I've been working on pandemic preparedness for about 20 years. And as you might all imagine, without much of an audience, because it just wasn't something that people were terribly focused on. But I think what we've been able to try to do the last 5 months is try to combine our work and be able to try to produce tools and everything from kind of the more scholarly work on what does governance look like to really very in the weeds practical advice. And for mayors to governors to, you know, industry leaders on, you know, things like, you know, should I wear a mask? When should I wear a mask? What type of mask should I use? What type of test should we? So it's been very, very operational, which is, again, a different part of my life, but it's been really busy the last couple of months. And I think to your question, like, where are we? Clearly, the public has COVID fatigue. And I think that public attention is certainly waning. We have a lot of other things going on in the country, clearly, right now. But the virus is still here. The virus continues. We still have widespread community transmission in many parts of the country. And the geography of the outbreak around the world is shifting a bit. So while parts of Europe have been extremely successful, New Zealand has now fully reopened, to everything but their borders. And so we're seeing some parts of the world have really gotten an excellent handle on the virus. They've been able to reduce transmission enough to really be reopening in a really robust way. We have other parts of the world that are kind of exploding at the moment and are considered hotspots. So and there are more cases in and around Mumbai right now than there were in all of China. And so India is exploding. Brazil is now the second largest number of cases around the world. We have lots of parts of Central and South America that are having many cases. So we're watching kind of the global picture, and then across the United States, you know, we are all moving forward. Every single state in the country is moving forward in some type of reopening. But there's now 14 states plus Puerto Rico that have had the highest 7-day average number of cases now than at any other point in the outbreak. So we're still seeing infection. I think clearly assume that the protests are going to lead to additional waves of infection as well. And I think, you know, when we talk about reopening, there's what's on paper, right? So there's, you know, a lot of municipalities or, you know, states have put forward language to say, you know, here are the metrics we're going to use to reopen. But because of all this fatigue and because of the economy, a lot are moving forward without actually having met those metrics. And then, you know, the other issue is what does compliance look like? So in an official plan, it might say, yes, we're reopening, we're moving forward, and everybody needs to wear a face covering, and everybody needs to maintain physical distancing. But then you look outside your window, and you're like, well, you know, how many people are actually doing that? And I think there's a tremendous amount of variation across the country in what individual behavior looks like, let alone the variations in kind of industry-led behavior.
So that's great, and I've already kind of told you I have the opportunity to ask all the naive questions that I have no basis for sort of asking. So we appreciate your expertise. But in some of those markets that you referenced, the increasing, you know, rates, is that not in response to just higher degrees of testing? You know, I'm not trying to use the phrase false positive, but is that skewing how we should be viewing that, or how should we look at that?
So I mean it's kind of hard to get your head around, right? Because you want to, we've been talking about for months, we need to test more, and then you're like, well, if we test more, we're going to get more positive, which is good, because if you get that, then you can contact trace, you can isolate, you can and you can try to contain the spread of the disease. But the metric that we tend to use, you know, one of been really fortunate to work on a number of different projects the last couple of months, and one of them that I've been supporting, but we didn't build is something called COVID Act Now, and so COVIDActNow.org, and it sets up four different indicators and kind of looks at the level of risk in any given state, and in many cases the actual counties as well. And one of the indicators that we look at in that is something called test positivity. And the idea behind that is it's kind of a composite measure, because you're looking at not only how many people are being tested, but also what the positive hit rate is. So the best measures are if you are testing lots and lots of people within your population and your percent positive is quite low. So in kind of late March, early April, test positivity across the country was hovering somewhere around 20%, because one, we weren't testing anybody, and two, the only people we were testing were folks who had like showed up at a hospital. Now we're down to somewhere an average of about 4 or 5% across the country. And as we look at that, we can say, you know, the WHO has provided a baseline metric, like you want to be under 10%. So we're good. We're now doing way better. So we're testing more people and we're getting this lower hit. But ideally, so like the South Koreas of the world, the countries that have done a really good job of containing the outbreak are under 3%, and in some cases closer to like 1%. So that's what we're trying to aim towards. So that's one of the things that we look at, because it allows us to look at both the amount of testing and how much you're hitting as positive.
So I would assume you think it's good news in New York City with all the testing up there and sort of the 1% level. That's that I would assume is a really positive outcome right now.
Yeah, and New York City looks, their epidemiologic curve looks a lot like Switzerland's right now, or some of the countries in Europe, where they had, unfortunately, a really horrible time for a condensed period of time, but then through very aggressive measures. And for the population really being very compliant with the government, they were able to reduce their numbers and really go back down to a number that's now manageable by public health interventions. Now, other parts of the country, in fact, the majority of the rest of the country, hasn't really done that. So we went up exponentially, and then we went down a little bit, and now we've plateaued. So we are continuing to come out with somewhere between 18 and 20,000 cases, new cases of the virus every single day. And that's of confirmed cases.
So, and I certainly want to come back to that, because I think there's a lot to talk about with that. But, you know, as we have begun reopening, has anything surprised you both positively? I mean, real estate folks are sort of positive by their nature. So, what surprised you positively, but also what, you know, other than, you know, the increase in sort of positivity rates, you know, what is, you know, maybe a negative outcome of what you've seen in the opening so far?
So I think I think it's been really fascinating. I don't know if it's positive or negative, but so many of the organizations that I talk to, they've basically figured out how to become their own public health departments. And they're making decisions that I don't think they ever expected to have to make. And so people have gotten incredibly smart. I talked to a CEO of a casino, of a resort and casino, and I am pretty sure that wasn't part of its training, but you know, he is now so smart about tests and PCR and the antibodies and different disinfectants, and people really kind of in part by necessity, but they've become really, really just smart and thoughtful about how to move forward in a safe and effective way. And so so in that respect, I feel like I need to be handing out a whole bunch of honorary master's in public health degrees to the general public. I mean, people, epidemiology, that most people didn't know what it was, is now something that kind of, at least basic concepts are well understood by lots of people, and particularly people who are trying to make decisions for their companies. So I think on that front, it's been really encouraging and exciting to see that. I think, you know, the challenges of, you know, what's been negative about the reopening process to date. It's been frustrating for me, and I'm sure frustrating for many people. Well, I mean, one of the reasons people have had to become so smart is because for a long time, the federal government was not providing the type of operational guidance that would have been expected. And that's been really challenging, and difficult to process, particularly for those of us who have worked with and watched, CDC for decades and kind of been inspired by their work. So, to see them kind of sidelined in so much of this has been challenging, and to see people really struggle has been very challenging too. But with that, I think the other challenge here is trying to figure out, and I don't want to say disappointing because it's we understand, but how to message to different types of populations and how to ensure that people's behavior matches what a policy is.
Yep. Well, you referenced the operator of the casino, which that's a really interesting issue today for a variety of reasons. But so at a very high level, if you were an operator of a casino or a building owner, where would you be focusing your attention and why?
Well, there's a lot of pieces here, right? And there's the work you have to do up front on the operational side. So you're trying to think through all the different ways to keep your environment safe and your employees safe and your customers safe if you have them. That to me is like a top line issue. And depending on what you do and, you know, what your employees look like and what the employer looks like and what customers look like, is that could be very complicated or it could be very simple. But to me, that's the first line. And then, as one reopens, I believe in data, and we can make better decisions if we have data. So keeping track of what happened. So okay, you've decided to reopen, and now you have X number of people back in your space. But are you monitoring that? And are you identifying, you know, what are your own case counts looking like internally within your organization? And do you have a relationship set up with the local health department so that you can communicate those findings back to them? And also, if you are in an environment that requires contact tracing. So the contact tracing is a function of the local public health department. But I think that depending on the size of your organization, it's also something that you can work with your health department to help facilitate.
So let's maybe talk a little bit about the data. Before we were coming on, Sonny Kelsey indicated he's got 1,400 employees that he's trying to get back in the building. So what data should he be zeroing in on? And what's the frequency of even looking at it, or how do you collect it? And, you know, what's the information he needs to be getting at?
So I think it depends on what type of environment you're coming back into. So I've talked to organizations that they haven't had a choice. They've had to operate and they've had to have employees working throughout this entire period. Sometimes they're critical infrastructure. Sometimes they are providing a service that everyone expects. And those organizations have put in really robust protocols because they have a responsibility to organize themselves. So they have set up symptom monitoring, like daily symptom monitoring, and sometimes that's as simple as, you know, you fill out a hand paper form and say, no, I don't have a runny nose today kind of thing. Or right. Sometimes it's been developed into kind of really, complete architectures where you have an app, and the app links to a temperature scan, and the temperature scan links to a pulse ox, and then, like, you know, if you get a red or a green light, and the green light then, you know, says you can go to work. If you get a red light, you report for testing. Sometimes the companies themselves have organized the testing for them, for their own employees. Sometimes they send them somewhere else to get tested. If you get the test result, that allows you to come back into work. So again, some places have depending on the type of organization you have, is the amount that you think about providing up front. So if you have a retail shop, clearly you're not going to do a symptom app monitoring check for every customer that walks in, but you're also going to want to make sure that you limit occupancy, you limit the number of people who are in your store at any given time. On the other hand, if you're providing a critical infrastructure, I've seen people sequester staff because they haven't had a choice and they to operate or not operate or have somebody call out sick. So I think it really is along a pretty broad spectrum, but I think symptom monitoring is key.
Yep.
And again, that could be very simple or very complex. And then depending on, you know, whether you're paying for the health insurance of the people coming into your space or not, or whether you've worked out or what kind of confidence you're trying to build within your community and what is available and how easy it is to access testing outside of your environment. Those are all things to be thinking about.
So if we spend some time just on the office asset today, right? And if you think about an office asset like, I don't know, 280 Park Avenue to pick something in New York City, and elevator cabs are pretty small and tall building, yep. How the heck do we get people back into the 50th floor of that building with any degree of efficiency?
Yeah, carefully. I mean, I think the entire idea, so first let me preface this by saying, let me provide some public health advice. Now, that might not always be what is economically feasible there's lots of other factors that play into people's decisions, but I think if you were gonna ask me about how do I get people onto the 50th floor of a building, one, on the public health side, the whole idea is that we don't want the same density that we've had before. And we're not going to want it for a while. So there are ways to get around that. I think for people who are able to continue to telework, it's still a really good option. And maybe that's not, you know, 5 days a week for the next 8 months, but it might be 4 days a week. Or three. I mean, there's different ways to think about, you know, how many people do you really need in your space at any given time? And when they are there, are you able to stagger the times that people show up? Can you limit occupancy at any given moment? Can you stagger the time? And that's helpful for also reducing the number of people who would have to be on public transportation at any given moment, because that's also of deep concern to most populations. Do you provide masks? Do you just ask for face coverings? I can't imagine a better way to market than literally people wearing your brand on your face. But yeah, again, I'm public health. I'm not a marketing person. Are you cleaning your space as much as possible? As we're learning, you don't actually have that. CDC is telling us that most contamination is through droplets and not necessarily through things you touch. But still, this is part of it is about public confidence. And so, you know, making sure that you are cleaning. For elevators, you can use the Hong Kong model, right? So when you walk into an elevator, is there a tissue that you take out and you use the tissue to push the floor and that goes into a trash can? And I've also seen elevators where the rule is, you know, depending on the size of the elevator, only a certain number of people in an elevator at any given time. So you're not talking about a situation where you're getting into a space like this, you're trying to cram in as many people as possible. And in fact, I've seen diagrams where you put the footprint down on the elevator floor, and this is where you can stand. And ideally, you know, I've also seen things where everybody like faces four different directions, which is a are, but I mean, there are ways to do it, and there's ways to, in none of these situations are you eliminating risk, but you're reducing risk.
So you brought up public transportation, and it wasn't on our list, in fairness to you, but you know, a lot of the office tenants or and the employees are dependent on public transportation, and maybe the work from home sort of solves that. And I saw a tweet from Mayor Cuomo yesterday with him on, you know, the subway in New York. And, you know, so what's your view of how these larger metros are managing the public transportation issue as it relates to this?
I think mayors and folks who run public transportation are desperate to convince the world that this is a safe thing to do, in the same ways that airlines are trying to convince the population that it's safe to fly. Now, I mean, if we think about it, so what do we know about the virus? We know that it is safer for you to be outdoors than indoors. We know that it is safer for you to be 6 feet or more apart from somebody else than not. We know that it is, you know, safer for you to not touch something that might have been contaminated than not. And also it is safer if everybody is masked than not. So if I think about that, you know, what kind of decisions do I want to make? Well, I don't necessarily want to be on a train or some type of subway car indoors where people might not be masked, where, you know, things might not have been cleaned, and definitely not being able to physically distance. On the other hand, if things are being cleaned often, if there's efforts to try to increase ventilation, because we know that that also helps, if there are efforts to stagger, to add cars, add train cars on, and to be able to ensure that people, or try to allow people to be physically distanced from each other, and to mandate that everybody wears masks, those are all things that will reduce the risk.
So by the way, I said Mayor Cuomo, I meant Governor Cuomo. That's, you know, the benefit of this being reported is we'll have that in perpetuity. So I look forward to getting razzed about that. And I didn't even have somebody text me saying I said it wrong. I actually got it myself. So we talked about, you know, public transportation. Many people on this call travel extensively for their jobs. The real estate business is all, at the end of the day, a local business that could be local in San Francisco, local in Hong Kong, local in wherever. And so a lot of the people on the phone are going to be traveling just to see clients and see projects and requiring their third parties to get through a building so they can continue due diligence. So what's your view of air travel relative to just where we are today, and how does that change over time?
Yeah, I think air travel is complicated. So I'm also, I work in global health, so there's a global part of that. And I think I would imagine that many of the people on this call, like myself, are used to, you know, traveling from DC to Hong Kong for 24 hours and then leaving. I mean, that's what we do. It's not terribly glamorous. And we're used to moving around the world all the time with very different, and not staying very long. I don't think that type of travel is going to be advisable for a long time. I think there's a lot of things to consider when we think about air travel. I'm global health, so I sit in the back of the plane. I sit in the back of the plane, like in economy with, you know, pushing with people. I don't want to do that. that situation has a very different level of risk for 14, 15 hours than sitting in first class where you have more space than flying private, where certainly has a larger carbon footprint, but is gonna allow you to reduce your risk of exposure to virus. So I think that's one level of consideration. The second is, you know, in March, in the first week of March, I was getting a lot of questions from people saying, you know, should I go on my spring break to name your country? Or I'm thinking about going to this conference here. And my answer, even the first week of March, was okay. I mean, you're going to do what you want to do, but anywhere you go, you have to expect to get stuck. And so I think when we think about travel, probably for the next 6 to 8 months, you're going to have to think about those factors. So you may show up somewhere that requires you to go through a 14-day quarantine. You may show up somewhere that doesn't have a quarantine at the moment, but might put one into effect. You might show up, like right now, if you fly into Hong Kong, it's about an 8-hour process just to get out of the airport, because you go through a full testing process, and they track you and you, where are you going. So again, these days where many of us would fly in somewhere, run off to our meeting, hop back on a plane, I don't think that's a reality that's going to happen for a long time.
Would your last statement change if we were only talking about domestic travel?
I think domestic travel is different, right? But I will still note that it's really uneven, and it might get even more uneven, because right now, there are still, I believe, a few states that have quarantines in place. So I think if I know that Memorial Day weekend, Delaware, where I have a beach house, had a 14-day quarantine in place for anybody coming in from out of state. So kind of defeated the purpose for me to drive to Delaware to be told I need to stay in my home and not be able to go outside. So I think that it's a little weird, and I have to be honest, I fully expect that there's going to be a whole bunch of legal challenges in trying to sort out what is the right of a state to keep somebody out and how they actually enforce that. But I think there are folks where that happens, where you, at one point, Florida was doing that for anybody flying in from New York. I know that there are some places where people were being stopped if they had out of state plates. So again, that's not really what we're seeing for most of the country right now, but it doesn't mean it might not happen again. So I think, again, you have to know that you might have to be a little bit flexible. So it might be more challenging to do the type of travel that we were all used to doing before.
Do you think, and again, travel is so important, so I'm going to maybe belabor, do you think 6 months from now, your opinion would be different, sort of thinking what you think is going to happen domestically?
It's really, here's the thing, it's kind of hard to make those predictions. Like, I can get out my crystal ball and I can tell you what I think is going to happen with the virus. I can also get out a crystal ball and tell you what I think we're going to be, or where I hope we're going to be, in terms of having more advanced medical countermeasures.
Well, I want to go there, by the way. I mean, that's at the end. I definitely want to get that opinion.
Yeah, but I think at this point, it truly is a crystal ball. I think a lot of this is going to be dependent on our ability to put effective public health measures in place and to get the cooperation of the American public, which right now is kind of eh.
Yeah. Well, if we go back to sort of a specific property type, and let's take apartments, for instance, there's a lot of people here that probably own apartments. If you were an apartment dweller today, what would you be asking of your building owner?
So at this point, I think it is about, what do you do with the communal spaces? I mean, I think there's great questions that one can ask about ventilation, but it depends what kind of building you're in and who controls the ventilation and what kind of HEPA filters you have in place. But I think mostly the questions that I think most people know to ask is about communal spaces. So how are people protected in those spaces? What kind of protocols would you put in place, or signage at least, for elevators? What do you do in the general spaces? I think that's about all you can ask at this point of the building owners. Maybe I'm really missing something.
Well, so would your answer be the same if Hilton Worldwide called you and said, we need your help pronto to figure this mess out and to help us, think through the problems that we have? Is it all about the communal spaces in hotels?
No, I mean, hotels are completely different, right? Because when I think about an apartment building, I'm thinking about, people who kind of own their space within their apartment.
Yep.
Or at least that, they're not expecting people to be coming in and cleaning. that they have an okay, that, you know, in some cases they may actually control their HVAC depending on what the building is. But I think a hotel chain is very different. Because one of the things we also look at is in an apartment, you're looking at the numbers in your community and you're trying to figure out, well, you know, it looks like, you know, we have really widespread community transmission in, you know, name your city. And your entire community is going to be taking appropriate actions that way. I think one of the challenges in a hotel is that you have people coming from very different home environments or, yep, you know, communities of the country or even around the world. And the rules are different and the expectations are different. So I think it's probably a lot more challenging because the organization itself in some ways kind of has to set the rules and the expectations that normally might just be set by the environment you're living in. So if you were living in New York City in an apartment building in mid-April, like it's not like you're thinking everything's okay, right? No. But if you're coming to a hotel and you're going to have people who might be coming from a hotspot, you might have people coming from a rural environment where they haven't seen a single case, and trying to set the standards and the expectations and the for what everybody needs to do in terms of behavior, but then also what is reassuring to the people who have to go to work there. So do they feel protected? Are they are there systems in place where you have, I don't know if the word is contactless, like check-in? Like, are there options for that? For the people who are manning a front desk, do they feel like they're protected? Is there plexiglass up? I don't know if that works for the aesthetics. But, you know, does everybody get a branded mask? Right. And then we're getting into, like, how many? Because you don't necessarily want to wear them all day, and if it gets wet, so does that become part of, like, a uniform, per se? Is there an opportunity for somebody walks? If you have the policy that you don't want anybody in your communal space that is, so it comes into a front lobby and doesn't have a face covering on, are they offered one? Then what is your process and policy for if they are offered one, but they declined?
Right.
And what have you, because what you don't want is somebody who happens to be working at the front desk that day having to make it up for themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, I think what you want is make sure that you have a policy in place that is based on the current best guidance from CDC or the local health department or whatever you've decided to go with, your medical or public health experts that give you the game plan. And so people aren't struggling to kind of, it's the same way you don't want like a TSA agent kind of making it up on their own. You want to have a structure in place. And then the same thing that goes for cleaning and the type of cleaning that you would do when somebody is in a room and staying multiple days, the type of cleaning that you would do when somebody checks out before somebody else moves in, the type of, I've heard that some hotel chains are kind of marking the room so that somebody knows the last time. If you are checking into a room, you can actually see when it was cleaned and when the last time somebody had actually been in that space was. Because the certain level of security and protection that you feel if you know that nobody has been in that space for, say, 48 hours. So I think there's a long list of stuff that you can start thinking about that not only protects the people who work for you, but also protects the people who come to stay with you, and also provides a level of kind of, even if it's not protected, it's kind of confidence in the organization and confidence that their safety is being taken seriously.
So I appreciate that. You know, part of the issue with getting people, you know, back to work is the elementary school, the middle school, and the high school kids going back to school. And I'll steer clear from whether or not Georgetown opens in the fall. That is for another conversation. But you know, and it's impossible to ask the question because every jurisdiction is so localized, and I understand that. But if you're New York City, for instance, and you're seeing sort of the testing rates that they're seeing up there, do those kids go back to school in the fall?
So I think I think every jurisdiction across the country would love to be able to see their kids back in school in the fall. Now, clearly that's going to be driven by what's happening with the virus. It's also going to be driven by an evolving evidence base. So as we watch what happens, so a lot of schools have started to reopen around the world. And when I say reopen, I don't mean like, okay, you know, the doors are unlocked and we go back to normal. Right. I mean, I think there's a lot of different approaches that are being tried. And from everything from reduced occupancy within a classroom to you close the cafeterias, to an excessive amount of hand hygiene, to I've seen some schools where they have all the kids wearing face coverings, which might work better in some populations than in others. So there's a lot of different tactics that are being tried that we're all studying pretty aggressively to figure out what of all these different tactics from your kids are in 2 weeks at a time and then off 2 weeks. So a lot of different measures that are being tried that we're trying to study, we're trying to figure out what is the best practice, and then at the same time trying to better understand the epidemiology. So as we knew from very early in the outbreak, thankfully, most children, not all, most children seem to, even if they get infected, have a relatively mild case. So we know that going in. Now, again, it's not for everybody, but for most. Now the question is that people are really trying to figure out if they get infected and they have this mild case, are they still able to bring it home and give it to their parents or even worse, their grandparents? Because a lot of the public health action we're doing is really at the core about shielding our most vulnerable populations. And so, there's been some research that's come out to say that in fact, they maybe there's a chance that they're not even that infectious. So these kids are not actually, they may get it, or they have a good chance of getting it, but they might not get all that sick. But even if they get it and they're not all that sick, there might be a chance that they're actually not even that, they might not even give it to their grandparents.
Yeah.
And that's critical information, right? Because if we know that, then we're just dropping those barriers to reopening schools.
So we're kind of entering the final phase of our conversation here. So maybe some more rapid fire questions for you and maybe more generalized questions. So, everybody wants to talk about the second wave and the fall and all of that sort of stuff. Where's your head at with that?
I think that, as I mentioned, most parts of the country are now plateauing. They're not actually dropping. So I'm not sure I would call it a second wave. Because I think that we still haven't really controlled the first wave. But I do believe that if schools reopen, if people are back in the workplace, there's going to be, and that we still have widespread community transmission throughout most of the country, then we are clearly going to see upticks in cases in the fall. And the question is going to be, are we ready for that? So do we have the supply chains in place? Do we have our frontline healthcare workers have the PPE that they need? Do they have the resources? Are they able to, do we have advances in the science and the clinical medicine? So we know that if somebody does get sick, do we have a better protocol for how to treat them quickly and get them out of the ICU faster? There's a lot of different pieces that go into that, but I do think we're probably going to see upticks in cases in the fall unless we can really get a hold of stuff but over the summer. And I think to me the only way to do that is through incredibly aggressive public health measures that I have not seen put in place anywhere in the country.
So if we think about this concept of sort of herd immunity, how long does that take, or what factor does that play into this conversation?
So I am really careful not to use that terminology at this point. because one of the, in the long list of things we still don't really understand about this virus is we don't understand natural immunity to it yet. So I think everybody hopes that once you've had it, that you can't be reinfected. Everybody hopes that once you've had it, you might be protected for a certain period of time. But as of today, whatever today is, June 9th, we don't know.
No.
So I think we all assume that if you contract the virus, that you develop some level of natural immunity for at least a matter of weeks. But we at this point do not know definitively if that lasts for months or even years. And if it doesn't, and you can get reinfected, then we shouldn't be doing our public policy based around that.
So not to be negative, but the common cold is a coronavirus, and so far we've not figured out a vaccine for that. So is this sort of fool's gold, do you think, in terms of this vaccine concept? Is it more of a therapeutics issue? And what confidence do you have in that being a real avenue of to take?
Yeah, so I think that one of the positive developments about this pandemic, let's try to find a few positive developments, is that pretty much every smart person in the world has been solely focused on it for a number of months, which means that we have the largest global effort ever to try to come up with a vaccine. There were at one point about 100 different vaccine candidates that were being experimented with. There currently seems to be just under 10 or 10-ish, somewhere between 8 and 10 truly viable candidates, many of which, and the U.S. through its Operation Warp Speed, such a silly name, is now focused on 5 vaccine candidates, all which have, I believe, novel platforms, plus the Chinese have at least 2 candidates that are more based on kind of more tried and true vaccine platforms. And many of these, I think most, all of these candidates are either in phase 1 or entering phase 2 clinical trials as we speak. Now, the clinical trial process is being accelerated. I'm a little nervous about that. I mean, I think it's clearly there is reason to accelerate and people are working really hard. But we're gonna have to get to a place where we can confirm that one of these vaccines, or ideally multiple vaccines, is safe and it's efficacious. So we want to make sure that it doesn't hurt us, and we want to make sure it works. And I doubt that any of these vaccine candidates will be 100% protective. I think we're likely to get a vaccine candidate sometime by the end of the year, maybe early in 2021, that is, that works, kind of.
Yeah.
And then we're going to have to deal with, and I assume that there might be multiple ones. So, right, you know, what, maybe we might get a candidate in January, we might have another candidate that comes out in June. I think we're going to continue to have to, even when things move forward, you're going to have to continue to collect safety data. Because, for example, how do you, if you do all of your clinical trials and all your safety data in a matter of months, how do you know that there won't be a congenital deformity if a pregnant woman takes it? So, I mean, these are really complicated trials, but yet they are moving forward so quickly because of just how important this is. And then once you have one, you then have to manufacture it and distribute
right.
it. So there's already a series of bets that are being made. There is one of the vaccine candidates is AstraZeneca's candidate along with Oxford University, and they just inked a deal with a manufacturer based in India to, I think, create 2 billion doses. And with the idea that there would be about 300 million doses ready by the end of the calendar year. Now, so they're already paying, they're already setting up the manufacturing plants, they're already like planning on rolling out this vaccine, even though they have no idea if it works yet. And that that same type of risk is, and those bets are being made on a number of the vaccine candidates, some of which is sponsored by the Gates Foundation, some of which is sponsored by government, but everybody is trying to make their best guess so that when we do have one that works, we're able to manufacture it as fast as possible and then try to figure out what distribution looks like, because, you know, there seems to be a global shortage of glass. So what does that mean for distribution? And then there's going to be some really thorny questions on prioritization. Who gets it first?
And are you seeing, you know, we've all read the articles about how this is sort of the new space race, so to speak, with us in China. But within the United States, at least, are you seeing a high degree of collegiality amongst these groups? Is it sort of everybody kind of working together, or is it everybody running their own show?
Well, I think on the vaccine candidates, it's everybody doing their own thing, because it is a race by different companies and different platforms to move forward. But I think that in terms of the response in general, that there has been a tremendous amount of collaboration and partners coming together that might not, and even within academia, right? Like I fight for grant money with a lot of my colleagues at different institutions, but we are all working together as much as we possibly can to be able to try to fill a void that we feel has been left by really the federal government, and to be able to we, as an example, you know, one of the things that we've done on one of our websites is come up with a set of metrics that local jurisdictions can adopt to think about, you know, are we meeting the criteria we need to meet in order to move on to, say, a next phase. There are several other of my colleagues at different institutions who have put forward something very similar. So we've actually all been meeting to figure out, you know, between Harvard and Hopkins and Georgetown and, you know, so our partners, including some of the major think tanks, can we come together around a set of common metrics, and can we, for where we diverge, to have a better narrative on why we diverge, so we can all speak to it and help, you know, help better guide people to different tools depending on what their needs are.
Perfect. So the last question, I even debate asking it for fear that we end on sort of a sour note, but is this sort of a new norm for forever? Or, I mean, are we always going to be sort of dealing with this sort of, you know, with this you know, virus issue for sort of the rest of our lives, so to speak? I mean, balancing that with the prior pandemics that have come and gone and so forth, is this something we're just going to have to live with a lot for a lot longer than what we would ever envision, like decades?
I certainly hope not. I mean, I think that this is the pandemic of the century. This is the 100-year event for us. Like this, while we see emerging infectious diseases all the time. I mean, we have from SARS to MERS to Nipah to Ebola West Africa to Ebola DRC to, you know, we've been watching to new strains of influenza. We watch emerging infectious diseases come around all the time. Thankfully, many of them are contained. They're regional, or like for in the example of the new strains of influenza that have pandemic potential, they haven't been good at sustaining human-to-human transmission. So as a discipline, as a challenge, we're not getting rid of the challenges of emerging infectious diseases anytime soon. That being said, when we talk about, like, you know, what do we live with going forward? I think we are all very hopeful that there will be some type of medical countermeasure that becomes available, whether it is a really great therapeutic or a vaccine, that we are able to move into, until that point, into this kind of a new normal. And even once we get into, you know, will we ever get back to a full normal? Maybe there's some things that we should, like, maybe adapt longer term. But I will also tell you that in my field, unfortunately, we suffer from what we call the cycle of panic to neglect. So what we'll have in our world, a major outbreak, and be like, great, now everybody's going to make major changes, And then, you know, 6 months later, like, I got some other things I got to worry about right now.
Right.
So from my perspective, I'm hopeful that that cycle will be a little bit more prolonged, that we'll have an opportunity to make some really substantial changes in our systems, in our global governance, in our capacity, so that when the next thing emerges, we're able to be better at preventing, detecting, and responding to it before it has the ability to explode into the type of global pandemic we've seen today.
Love it. Well, that's a good way to and a good place to stop. So, you know, Professor Katz, I'm super proud, and I'm proud that you're at Georgetown, and really appreciative of the work you're doing on all of our for all of our benefit. Those on the phone, I'm sure Professor Katz is always in sort of fundraise mode, and so her work is very important, and we want to support that work. So your support of her is very much appreciated by all of us. So with that, Professor Katz, thank you so much. I really appreciate you, and I appreciate you taking the time, and I appreciate everybody on the phone for joining us. Thank you to Sunny Kelsey for getting us kicked off, and everybody be well and stay safe, and I hope to see you soon. Thank you.
Thank you all.